Do you consider yourself a fairly productive person, and yet somehow you always put off working on building your business? If so, I hear you. And today I'm going to share with you 5 tips to help you beat that procrastination and get moving on your business goals. Hi there, if you are new here, I'm Luisa Zhou, and around here we like to talk about all things business and entrepreneurship related. The tips I'm going to be sharing with you today are hard-earned tips after 2 years of me working a job and trying to get started building my business on the side. So it was not like I was naturally productive or things just took off in building my business right away. In fact, I was really confused because up until that point, a few years ago, when I was trying to start my first online business, I considered myself a pretty productive person. But somehow I would go to work, I would come home, I would tell myself, hey, I'm gonna work on my business today and build my dreams and do all this amazing stuff. Then I'd come home, wanna watch TV, and then put it off every single day. Spoiler alert, I figured it out. That's why I'm able to be here with you today. And so I'm gonna share with you 5 things that really helped me turn those 2 years of procrastination around. Tip number one that I have for you is to leverage what I call your procrastination momentum. And what that is you know when you procrastinate and you feel bad and then you build up like this feeling inside of yourself and a day comes, you sit down, you use that to motivate yourself to get a lot of stuff done. Maybe it's like a 1 hour, 2 hour, 3 hour or more work session and you feel so amazing afterwards. That is what I like to call procrastination momentum. And what you wanna do using one of those bursts of productivity is to use it to do the things that are gonna help you continue taking action. So what I mean by that is, for example, once I realized, okay, you know what? I'm realizing that I'm doing a burst of work maybe once a month. How can I use this to motivate myself to continue working after that burst? So I learned to get strategic about how I use that time frame. What I mean is maybe I would sit down and I would create a good amount of content so that in the future, when I was feeling lazy, I could just paste that content and share that in different places, which would be a lot easier, and I could do no matter how resistant I was feeling to actually doing any work. And by the way, if you want some tips on how to create content quickly, I've got a video for you that I'll put up there. Another example of how I would use that time is maybe I wanted to go out there and pitch myself to different publications to share the knowledge that I had. So for example, when I was doing Microsoft Excel consulting online, I wanted to pitch Lifehacker and productivity publications to share my tips for Microsoft Excel. And so I would use that productivity burst to research all the different places that I could pitch, who I could pitch to, and what the requirements were for being pitched. That way, even in the future, after that burst, when I wasn't feeling as productive, I'd already done the heavy lifting, essentially. I could just look at my list of research, places to pitch, who to pitch to, what to say, and just put it together real fast and send it off. And that's what I mean by productivity momentum, where you create enough momentum from one of those bursts that you make it easier in the future, even when you're not feeling as productive, to continue taking action. And then what happens over time is you do more and more of these bursts because you start seeing more results, you start making more progress, it becomes easier to sit down and do the work, and it just snowballs. Tip number two I have for you is to go with your flow. So what I mean by that is I am sure you have read plenty of articles about waking up early in the morning, doing an hour of work beforehand, and then going off to work. Let me tell you, I try that so many times, but the fact is I'm just not a morning person. I am a grumpy bear in the morning. I am not alert. I am not productive, and it's just not me. However, what I am is a big night owl. So what I would do is I would wake up in the morning, I would go off to work, do no work on my business, do my work during the day, of course, the job that paid my bills, and then I would come home, I would eat really quickly, then I would sit down on my sofa and I would work. Now that meant that some days I might have 30 minutes of really good work in me. Some days I might have 15, some days I might have none because it was a really hard day at work. But what that did was it started creating a habit for me where I knew as night came on, I was gonna start getting more productive, I was gonna start becoming more and more alert, and my body started realizing, okay, this is when Luisa does a little bit extra work, and it really became this habit. So for you, whatever that looks like, whether it's 8, 9 p.m. in the evening like it was for me. Maybe for you it is 4, 5 a.m. in the morning. Whatever that is, figure that out and go with that. And let me just add a side note that it's not gonna be perfect. There are gonna be days where you are gonna feel so sleep deprived and you're gonna walk around asking yourself, what the heck am I doing? That's normal, frankly. I have not seen a single person be able to manage all of this and come away with 8, 9, 10 hours of sleep every single day. You learn to balance it a little. Some days you get a little more sleep. Some days maybe you stay up until 2 a.m. working on a pop-up like I did once. And the next day you're a little bit sleepy. But it balances out because you've got a goal and you know what you're working towards. Tip number 3 that I have for you is a little bit counterintuitive. It's to focus on the short term. So there's a lot of advice out there that tells you to motivate yourself by focusing on your big why, focusing on your big vision, on your big picture goals. Guess what? I tried that a lot. And the thing with that is it can feel really far off and unrealistic and frankly overwhelming. I would sit down and think about, oh my gosh, I want to build this amazing business. I want to really help a lot of people. And I want to be able to take care of my loved ones financially and be with them more as well. And I was so far removed from that in the beginning when I had my job and no business and didn't know any entrepreneurs that I would sit down and I would just completely go into overwhelm. My mind would blank. I'd be like, oh my gosh, I don't even know where to start. There's so much to do. I don't know. All these thoughts and fears would start getting into my head. And then I would start thinking, oh my gosh, I'm so far off from that. It's gonna take me so long. There's so much to do. There's an unending list. Can I actually do it? And it would just create this whole crowd of voices in my head and I wouldn't get anything done because I'd be so overwhelmed. What I eventually figured out instead was, okay, you know what? Forget that long-term vision. What I can do instead is just focus on one short-term goal at a time. And when I say short-term, I mean the shortest term goal that you can imagine. And you have to play with this a little bit. Some days my goal would be, my gosh, I'm just gonna pitch one publication that I could share content for. Or I'm going to find one online forum or Facebook group that my ideal clients might be in. Some other days, I might set a goal for the week where I would say, this week, I wanna pitch this many places. I want to connect with this many potential people. I want to post online this many times in this many places. But that was pretty much the extent of it. I didn't really go beyond a week for the first few months where I was starting to see progress with doing this. And that's because, you know what they say, don't fix what isn't broken. It was working, and so I thought, okay, you know what? I'm starting to quiet the overwhelm. I'm starting to see how this is making a little bit of progress. All right, let me not go into the worrying about how am I gonna do this consistently? How am I gonna get more clients and so on and so forth? One baby step at a time. Now, the next 2 tips that I have for you are less tactical, more mental and emotional, but honestly, they made the biggest difference to me in helping me overcome and beat that procrastination. So here they are. Tip number 4 is to face your fears. And here's why. I have seen time and time again that people who are naturally pretty productive. So for you, for example, you've probably done pretty well in school. You know how to study and at least pass and do okay. And you've probably done well in your career as well, and you consider yourself a fairly productive person. So why is it then that you are behaving out of character for working on your business, right? And you keep on putting it off. It's not because we're lazy. And I beat myself up about this for so long because I thought that was the case. I just thought, oh, I must be naturally lazy in this one area for some reason. And when you sit down and think about that, that doesn't really make sense, right? Eventually, I realized that what was going on was not that I was somehow magically becoming lazy in this one area. It was because I had so many fears that were popping up when I even thought about working on my business. Some of these fears are probably gonna sound familiar to you too. I remember thinking, this is just a pipe dream. What's the point? This is not gonna work out anyways. I remember thinking, I'm just wasting my time. I could be spending this time with my friends, with my family, just chilling, doing other things that I want, and this is just gonna be a big waste of my life. I remember thinking, man, this is so silly. I should be focusing on my career and growing that more because that is the steady, proven thing. It's the thing that I have and know. What is this business thing? I remember being afraid of putting myself out there, of having nobody respond to me, of looking really stupid, of having to be less than private with my personal life. All of those things popped up. And in the beginning, I didn't even realize those fears were popping up, but those were the things that were getting in my head when I was sitting down to think about working on my business. And if you think about it for yourself, I'm pretty sure that's gonna be true for you as well. So what you wanna do is really take a little bit of time, sit down and write down all the fears and thoughts that have been coming up for you. Once you get them down on paper, you can really get clear on what they are in the first place, and then you can face them. So for me, for each one of those, after I wrote them down, I was able to say, okay, this is the fear and this is how I'm going to address it. Now, I want to be super clear. It's not like I was able to overcome all those fears and they just magically went away. No, I still had them. That's how it works for most people. But what it did do for me was allow me to get a handle on them so they weren't controlling my every thought and move. So for example, the fear that I was wasting my time, I reasoned to myself, I said, hey, this could be a waste of time, but the truth is, I'm gonna commit to doing this for at least a few months, a year, 2 years. I've already wasted 2 years thinking about this, so might as well put in a few more years where I'm actually committed and see where this goes. I also reasoned to myself, look, it's not like I'm just slacking off at work. I'm still doing a good job. I'm still giving it my all as much as I can. And so I'm still gonna move ahead if that's where I wanna end up going. Plus, I thought, okay, I have time to hang out with friends, work on myself, watch TV, I can put a little bit of that time towards my business. And in the long run, if it doesn't work off, I'll still have done something. I'll have grown in some way. I'll probably have made some money, hopefully, and I'll consider that a good investment. And I did that for every single fear. And I did that repeatedly. I reminded myself of my reasoning every time those fears came up, which was quite often. I will say the most powerful thought that helped me was this thought. 10, 20, 30, 40, 50 years from now, if I don't do this, how much am I going to regret it? Not am I going to regret it, because I know there will be a little bit, but how much? Is it going to be so big that even if I was really successful in my career, I would think, oh man, what could I have done on my own if I just trusted myself and believed and put a little bit more into it? And that regret was so overwhelming for me just thinking about, I mean, this is a little bit morbid, but thinking about lying on my deathbed, thinking, man, I could have done that. I think I could have, I really should have. And wow, that was my life. That really motivated the heck out of me to really quiet those fears, at least for a little bit every day, to be able to continue working on my business. The final tip that I have for you is to find your real why, your real motivation. Now you might be thinking, wait a second, Luisa, earlier, didn't you just say, don't focus on your why? Yes, I did. But this is not a contradiction, because here's why. Not to say why too many times, but the truth is, when you are thinking about your motivation, there's the, hey, this is the pure heroic theoretical motivation, right? I wanna change the world. I wanna change my life and have amazing income and freedom. Then there's the more closer to heart, tangible, maybe it feels even selfish, why and motivation. That second one is the one that so few people talk about, but it's the one that I found to really help you when you're getting started. It's because, yes, I'm sure you wanna do amazing things and you're gonna, once you get out there, really help so many people. However, when you're just starting out, you're working through your own fears and doubts and all of your own stuff, that can feel really far off. Is it gonna feel motivating to work on yourself and your fears and do all this work that may or may not pay off in the beginning just to think about helping someone else? I will tell you, at least for me, I am just not that altruistic. It was just like, okay, I mean, I wanna do that, I wanna care about that, but right now, I can't even get myself to sit down and work on my business for 5 minutes, so that's not the main priority for me right now. And that's the honest truth. So what I had to really dig into to figure out was, okay, what's a why that's important enough for me right now that it is grounded, it is real, I feel it inside myself, and it is enough, it is big enough for me to motivate me to face those fears. And for me, it took me a really long time to find that, partly because I was trying to search for my big why and not understanding why it wasn't motivating me enough. And for me personally, what it ended up being was I couldn't be motivated for myself. the truth was life was good enough. I had a good job, I had a good salary. It wasn't amazing, it could have been better. That's why I wanted to start a business and see what else I could accomplish, but it was pretty darn good. However, what happened was in about 2014, over the span of a year, all of my loved ones had something life-threatening essentially happen to them. My father was rushed to the ER for emergency heart surgery. My mother was diagnosed with cancer, and my sister got hit in the eye with a freak snowball and she almost lost her eyesight. And I remember there was this one specific moment. So my sister, thankfully, she was able to stay with me during that time, and I had to go to work and leave her. I didn't have enough vacation days to take off for everyone. And at that point, I'd already used up a lot of the vacation days on visiting my mom and my dad. And I remember closing the door on her. She had to wear this patch over her eye and she couldn't watch anything, read. She just couldn't move either eye because the doctor said, look, you need to just rest them or else they might not heal and you might not regain your vision. So I had to turn off the lights, leave her in the dark. She was listening to, I think, an audiobook or something, and she just had to sit there all day. The doctor said, try not to move too much. I remember closing the door on her. She was super young at that time. I think she was in her teens. And I remember feeling like the worst sister in the world. Right? I couldn't be there and sit with her and just read to her, make her laugh. I just had to leave her in the dark for the next like 8 to 9 hours at least. And I remember thinking, this is the reason why I need to get out of this, not funk, but this like complacency cycle that I've been in where things are good enough and they'll just keep on going and I'll just follow the momentum of working my career. And I need to do something that in the future, if this happens again, I can take as much time as I need to off to be there for my sister or whomever it is that I care about. And that mental image gave me the motivation to put myself out there. It gave me the motivation actually to record my first video years ago. Believe it or not, I used to be so scared of doing video, I could not. But that gave me the motivation to do all of that so that when I was posting on Facebook back then, writing my first post and thinking no one's gonna care about this, this is really boring, who wants to hear about anything I have to say, I'm gonna look so stupid. It was, Luisa, it's time to shut those fears up. Not in a mean way, but just in a, hey, I'm not here for that way. Talk to the hand. And really focus on the things that matter, because what's more important? You seeing if you can do this so that that mental image never has to happen again, or you listening to your fears. That's what I mean when I say find your real why. And as time goes on, trust me, you're gonna overcome your fears, you're gonna overcome your doubts, because nothing beats them, those things, more than taking action and having that experience and confidence build through that. And as you build all of that and your own confidence grows, your why is going to expand. Like nowadays, I have the freedom and the financial liberty to be able to do that, to be able to take care of my family, to be able to take time away. And so that has freed me up to focus on really bigger impact things. The theoretical pure whys that so many people talk about. And it's amazing and it's great, but I couldn't start there. It just wasn't enough for me. And so I really want you to think about that for yourself as well. So hopefully this has left you feeling a little more motivated, a little bit more excited to get out there and take action and beat that procrastination. And if so, and you're excited to do that, I've got another great video to continue helping you. And that is a video on proven rules for building a six-figure online coaching business. I'm gonna share that for you somewhere on the screen and or in the description below so that you can check that out and continue building this momentum to make progress and get things going. Now, on top of that, let me tell you, nothing will motivate you more and frankly force you to not procrastinate than getting your first paying clients. That makes it so real for you. And so what I've got is a great PDF on a 15-second script to use to get your first paying clients. I'm gonna link that PDF for you in the description below. So make sure you go ahead and grab that if you want it. If you have loved this video and you are not yet subscribed, make sure also that you hit the subscribe button and the bell to be notified when I release a new video on something related to succeeding as an entrepreneur every single week. The only thing I can promise is that something will be massively valuable and hopefully fun for you to watch as well. All right, that's it for today. Thanks so much for being here, and I will see you next time.